Hello, everyone, and thanks for joining us on this episode of Healthytarian Living. I am joined by special guest Caryn Hartglass. Caryn, hello and welcome.
Hi.
And we are going to be talking about your journey and your work, which really stems into areas of responsible eating and living. And how can we apply this when it comes to our diets and when it comes to not just keeping our bodies healthy, but our planet healthy as well. So for anyone who may be new to your work, I will share with the audience. Caryn is a writer, speaker, interview host, and vegan activist who has been spreading the message about the benefits of a plant-based diet for over two decades. For 9 years, she was the executive director of the nonprofit EarthSave International, founded by John Robbins. And in 2011, she founded Real, Responsible Eating and Living, a not-for-profit corporation dedicated to educating about positive solutions for our health and planet. And Caryn has been featured in numerous popular media, and it is such a wonderful, wonderful pleasure to have you with us here today. So Caryn, I know that when it comes to the work that you are doing, as with so many of us on the planet today, there seems to be something so powerful about what gets us started, or what's the catalyst that pivots our journey into a specific or certain direction, especially when it deals with planetary change and working for the betterment of all our human family, our animal family, just positive global change in general. So can you start by sharing your journey and what that catalyst was for you?
Sure. First, I want to say I'm so happy to meet you here, even though it's just via video monitor. It's very easy to get frustrated in the current climate, and it's always so empowering and inspiring to know that there are other people out there doing wonderful work and that we're all in this together. So thank you for that, and I was so delighted to discover you and your work.
Oh, you're so very welcome, and I so resonate with that because it's so true.
I just want to give you a hug.
Well, thank you, and it really is so true that it can be very challenging when we look at sometimes that on our planet and just what's happening in general, but knowing that there are more and more of us really, really doing work that, again, where the foundation is to really help all of us have a higher quality of life, but that also includes all living beings as well.
Yeah, so my story started, I guess, when I was born. I came out like stomping and shaking. But I always felt that there was some sort of injustice that didn't make sense to me. I didn't understand once I discovered that there were people that went hungry. I was very young when this dichotomy became aware to me, and it just didn't make sense. And why wasn't everybody that I knew doing something about it? I didn't understand that. Then the light went on. I was a teenager when I realized what was on my plate. And I didn't want to kill animals. It was very simple. And this was a long time ago, and we didn't have the internet, and it was really hard to learn about eating healthfully without eating animals. My mom was very worried. She took me to the family doctor. He knew nothing, and he was rather patronizing and insulting about what I should do. And fortunately, I had enough sense not to listen to him. And so I became a vegetarian when I was about 15 years old. And it wasn't until about 15 years later that I became a vegan, because I found materials, and I, like many people, learn where milk comes from and how cows are treated and how it's connected to cancer and other illnesses, and it just didn't make sense to consume dairy products. So they were off the list, and I've just been doing that ever since. And I'm not a shy person, and when people ask me why I do what I do, I just start rattling off things. I think I've become a little more sensitive and sophisticated in how I proselytize. I wait for an opportunity rather than pushing on people. But basically, I've been sharing the same message for a very long time.
Now, what else is so powerful about your journey is, aside from what I call sometimes, you know, that self-driven inclination and inquisitiveness about what is going on just beyond our particular homes and communities, You also had a powerful shift in your journey as cancer became a reality at one point in your life. And yeah. You've now been, I believe it's 7 years, cancer-free. Can you share with us how that transpired for you?
Yeah, well, as a vegan and somebody who's pursuing a healthy diet for very long, I felt somewhat invulnerable, that nothing could happen to me because I was, you know, super vegan. And then I didn't like going to doctors very often, and I didn't have really obvious symptoms, and so I wasn't really doing much about it, but then I was becoming anemic. My periods were becoming more frequent, and then my belly started to expand, so I had to do something. And I went off to India for 2 weeks, and I was carrying a bottle of aspirin with me because I was so uncomfortable. And by the time I came back, I was trying to avoid surgery, but there was no way at that point, I realized. So I went in, had a hysterectomy, and when I woke up, I learned I had advanced ovarian cancer. It just didn't compute. And from that point on, every time I went into an examining room, speaking with doctors, and they would ask me questions, I kept saying, I don't belong here. This isn't me. I'm a healthy person. This just doesn't compute. But I have kind of given a lot of thought to what happened and why it happened. I believe my diet over the years really saved my life and extended my life. And if I hadn't been doing what I'd be doing, I'd be dead. And I just needed to get this whatever problem was out of me. And then I improved my diet a bit. I have a daily green juice. I have one with me right now to life. And I just became even more savvy about health and nutrition than I was before.
And you know, those are excellent points because so often, I mean, it touches upon the famous example, as I always bring up in various, you know, groups or one-on-one, where people say, but I know somebody who's been so healthy and yet they still got, or somebody who smoked and ate whatever they wanted. Yeah. And, you know, but, you know, as at least from my teaching, there's always that deeper mind-body connection or the environmental toxins that can also have an impact on us. There's so much going on under the surface that while diet is so critical and there's so much we can do, we have to understand that there is so much when it comes to the holistic nature of our life. And so something you brought up as well is that you refined your diet, and green juices, for example, are such an integral part. And greens in general, can you talk a little bit more about those and why they are such a critical aspect of anybody's journey, but especially also vegan and vegetarian?
Right. Well, my understanding behind the dark leafy green foods is not only do they boost the immune system and make your immune system as powerful as it can be, but they also help in detoxing, cleansing the body. They help take the bad things out. And they also have very powerful anti-cancer fighting properties. So it's like a triple whammy of things that it does, and probably a whole lot more that we don't even understand. And so my diet is centered around greens. At the time I was going through treatment, I eliminated sugar and anything that could create a sugar environment, like high white flour, super. I wasn't eating junk food, but at this point, I wasn't going to touch anything ever, at least while I was going through treatment. I've kind of loosened up a little bit now. I have treats from time to time, but still I have it's focused on kale, dark leafy green vegetables, very little salt, oil, sugar, and I don't even eat a lot of grains, and a lot of raw, of course, and the greens, I just know my body and I, we have these conversations and we both agree.
Yes.
My consciousness and my body, we both believe in the greens.
Outstanding to hear. Outstanding. And you know, so many others too, I find, do have that pivotal journey with greens. If you, I'm sure, are familiar with the Butenko family, that's
sure.
Something that they've also, they were going down a certain path in their vegetarian or vegan path, but then it wasn't until those greens got included that it really got boosted. And so that's something else that I think we should always leave the audience with, is the power of greens and really basing our diets on them is just such a powerful thing. And you've got some wonderful recipes, I know, with videos about green, you know, juicing and smoothies and different treats and such. So definitely I recommend for our audience to check those out. Now, as we continue talking about diet, it comes down to, as your journey was progressing and you were getting involved with, you know, on a global scale, talking to people and such, you founded Real. And can you talk a little bit more about that? What was behind it and where are you taking it now?
Yeah, well, I was involved with EarthSave International for a long time, originally as a board member, and then I became executive director. And there were lots of wonderful things I learned from that experience. And I'm very grateful to the people that I met, because I think part of the reason I'm alive today is because I did connect with many alternative health practitioners that helped me when I was in need. Very grateful for that. Very grateful. And but there were things that I wanted to do that wasn't really in line with where that organization was going, and I wanted to do it my way. I think we all have something to contribute, and my message may resonate with some people. It may not resonate with others, and that's why we need diversity in the message to resonate with all the different people that are out there.
Absolutely.
And I wanted to put my spin on it, and my partner, Gary, became involved in my life just when I needed him. I knew him for a long time, but we reconnected a couple months before my cancer diagnosis. And he has his own story too, because he lost about 100 pounds on this diet, and he made peace with his food after struggling all his life. And the two of us love food, and we just decided to combine all of our talents. We're both performers. He's an actor, director, producer. I've sung opera, musical theater. We wanted to bring great joy to this discovery of delicious food that is gentle on the planet and the best for our health, and show people it really is easy, and just put it out there like that. And he came up with the name Responsible Eating and Living, which I love. I love the acronym REAL. And we're still fine-tuning what it is we want to do. It's kind of guiding us, but we've come up with a musical theater piece called The Swinging Gourmets, and we've done it a few times, and we want to do it a lot more. The whole focus is just, this is not deprivation. This is happy. This is delicious. We eat, we make most of our meals, and now that the weather's been nice for the summer, we eat outdoors on our terrace. We live in the city, and it's just great to be outdoors. And almost every meal, we say, we are so lucky. People have no idea how delicious food can be.
Yes.
We've got the best food right here. And so we put those recipes up on the website.
Beautiful, and I can so relate. It really is so delicious and so incredibly beautiful, and just, it, you know, makes you feel so good. And I know you can resonate and relate to that, because there's just no, it's something that has to be, as I always say, experienced. It's not just that, you know, our taste buds enjoy, it's that our whole body enjoys. And there's something happening on a deeper level that just enlivens us when we eat real, living, whole plant foods. And so that's where the message really from Real resonates into different areas. One is, of course, responsible eating. And you mentioned a very important point about, why is there even hunger on our planet and such? Let's get down to the fact that, okay, we've got lots of scientific research even today, all pointing that whole food plant-based is the way to go for our health. But let's talk about the other issues and how we can apply responsible eating and living. What's going on when it comes to hunger in the world? Why are we basically having such a hard time feeding when we're wasting so much food in our countries?
I want to think that all humans are good. I want to believe that. I want to believe that deep inside we have the capacity to be the best that we can and do the most good. But unfortunately, some people end up going down a path that misguides them, and they end up doing things that aren't really best for themselves or for the planet. And capitalism, our current economy, is not good for people. This needs to change. Now, I have no problem with people profiting, but there needs to be a social element. There needs to be a compassionate element in all business, in all things that we do. Somehow that needs to be woven back into society. There's this violent element that we see all over the world. And there are some theories that by eating animals and eating their fear, we eat those emotions and we express them. There might be something to that. So I'm just doing my part to help bring people back to a place where we can all make a difference and do good things on the planet. But unfortunately, things are really, they almost seem out of control. So we have these corporations, they're very profit-minded, and they're making things convenient for people. And people don't want to change when they feel like they're going to lose something, either economically or it's going to be more uncomfortable or inconvenient for them. So when I tell people, find your kitchen, start learning how to make your food, people are, I'm so busy, I've got my kids, I've got my job, I don't have time for this. And yet they have time for so many other things that I personally, I don't know what's going on in other people's heads, but personally I think they will get more fulfillment out of spending more time in the kitchen with their families and making meals together rather than spending time either on a video screen or on the computer or on their phones or on an iPad or watching television or getting their nails done or shopping or whatever. This is endless. Now, I could be wrong, but this is just what I believe, and I kind of invite people to discover that.
Yeah,
and we all have a part to play. You know, we just had this climate change event yesterday. I did not march, but my spirit was there in New York with everyone. And it's going to take everyone to make changes.
Absolutely. And, you know, when people hear the term climate change, the unfortunate part, what I think, that's happened today, is that there's such a division, it seems, where we have people working for, again, really taking care responsibly of our planet. And we have this backlash of climate change is just a hoax, there's nothing happening, dot, dot, dot. Where do we even begin there?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I had the opportunity earlier in this year to speak to 250 cattle producers about climate change and how animal agriculture, it affects climate change. I'm still blown away that I was invited to this event. It was at a bull sale at a livestock feedlot. And there were four of us on the panel. And I went as the lone vegan. I wore my cowboy attire. It was all vegan. I had this faux leather jacket and faux leather cowboy boots and a faux leather cowboy hat. And at first I was a little concerned about wearing these clothes, thinking they might think I was making fun of them. But when I showed up, everybody was wearing these things, so I really fit right in. Climate change is very complicated, and there are all these different numbers out there, depending on how you look at it. Some say 4% of the human-induced greenhouse gases are caused by animal agriculture, and then the far end is 51% of human-induced greenhouse gases can be attributed to animal agriculture. I don't know what the real number is, because I've actually looked at the math to calculate it, and there are a lot of estimates, there are a lot of guesses, so there is a lot of variability. All I know is that animal agriculture is devastating to the environment, not just greenhouse gas emissions, but to biodiversity and to air pollution, water depletion, soil erosion. It's all bad. We've got piles of manure. We don't know what to do with them. This has got to stop. And the point I try to tell these cattle producers and what I try and tell everyone else is if you compare the ways we can feed people, the most efficient way, it's obvious, is to feed people with organically produced plants. So if we're growing animals to feed people, we have to grow a lot of food to feed them, and that means a lot of pesticides and herbicides and petrochemical-based fertilizers. That all comes from fossil fuels, and that takes the carbon that's been sequestered down in the earth and brings it up into the atmosphere, and it pollutes and warms the atmosphere. So there's the fossil fuels, and there's all this energy just to grow these plants, to feed animals, to feed people. The process that we use today is not planet friendly because we're growing too many simple same crops. We monocrop, there's no biodiversity, and agribusiness, giant agribusiness, is trying to get to use the least amount of people and the biggest amounts of equipment to produce all of this efficiently. And efficient is a bad word because, sure, we want to do things efficiently, but we have to consider everything. Is agribusiness producing plants, soy and alfalfa and other cereal products with petrochemicals and fertilizers, is it efficient in terms of we're putting people out of work? Is that good? We are destroying the environment. Is that good? We are depleting our soil. Is that good? We're destroying all the little bugs and the whole ecosystem inside the earth. There's just so many different parameters that aren't considered when we think about efficiency.
Mm-hmm.
It's a complicated problem. So I try and tell people the most gentlest thing. It's, if you think about it, it's obvious. Organic plant production requires no petrochemical-based fertilizers. It requires no pesticides and herbicides. And it helps if you do it correctly. There are some organic plant productions that aren't as sustainable and friendly as others, but we could all learn how to make it the best possible that we can. And there's no one-size-fits-all solution for the plants that we're going to grow. Some plants thrive in some places. Where I was in Nevada with these cattle producers, there were so many drought-tolerant plants mm-hmm. that they could be growing that could improve their environment there rather than feedlotting these animals. There's a lot that can be done.
Yeah, and you've touched again upon so many important issues and points of personal responsibility, because I find so often so many people don't even want to hear this, don't even want to face these, you know, topics or issues or challenges, because they feel helpless. They're like, you know, this is too much for me. I don't know what to do.
Yeah, it's complicated.
But what you're proposing, really, at the end of the day, it starts with the simple changes in our own lives, in our kitchens, in our meals. What are we going to keep supporting? What are we going to choose to feed ourselves and our families with? And that's where making the choice to more plant food is a huge step in the right direction for all of us. When you talked about the animals and, of course, the degradation of the environment and the different levels of pollution and such, another important point, which brings us back to the hunger problem in our world, is that so much food is being given to the animals to feed us, rather than using that initial food, the plant food, to feed so many more in the world. A lot of people don't connect those dots yet either. Can you speak a little about this?
Yes. So I don't know what the correct term is to call countries today outside of the Western world, the United States and Europe, because I don't really care for the terms that after World War One, after World War II, we had we considered ourselves the first world countries, yeah. And those that weren't part of the Allied countries, they were the third world countries, and then that morphed into developed countries and developing countries. And I don't know if there is a correct term anymore, but there are countries outside of the United States in Africa, India, Middle East, and they're not doing things exactly as we're doing them, and many of them subsist on farming, rely on farming, and there's this problem of distribution, and it has to do with politics, it has to do with the economy and wealth, and there are some individuals who own a lot of land, and they hire people to work on that land, and they're choosing, more often than not, either to grow commodity foods like sugar and coffee and tobacco, or grow plants to feed animals, to feed people. And all of this stuff is not to feed the people that are there in their countries. So these people are doing the work, and then they end up not having enough money or not enough food. And it's our fault, because we're getting all that food. We're importing either the animal products or the commodity foods. And it's a mess, and people don't even realize.
Yeah.
And it's all connected, and it's all about food.
Yes, and that's such a huge point. It's all connected, and it's all about food. And going back to something else I mentioned, is the food that we waste is just atrocious. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we can all definitely do our part on, and basically even become more efficient in our own homes and financially by not wasting so much and then saying, you know, we have to spend so much. You've also hit upon the aspects of organic farming, and that's an important point as well, that if we are choosing our foods, specifically whole plant foods, that we do tend to go for the organic ones as well. And as I say today, you know, it's unfortunate that we almost have to sell people on organic food when it should be, you know, the obvious choice. But what more would you like to say with respect to that?
So you probably heard this, but when many vegans talk about eating plants, people think, oh, you care so much about the animals and you don't care about people. And this is one of the important things about organic farming. Now, I care about myself very much and my family, and I don't want to eat food that has any pesticide or herbicide residuals. I don't want to put toxic chemicals in my body. But then I think also of the people that are growing and harvesting my food. And many of these people, for the most part, are not paid well. Many of them are immigrants, either legal or illegal. And if they're using pesticides and herbicides, they're exposed to all kinds of toxic chemicals. And even though there are regulations about how these chemicals are supposed to be used, many times they're not following them. And it's not their fault. It's usually the people that are directing them to do their work. And I've read so many horror stories about how they come home and they even share some of this toxicity with their family. The husbands come home and the wives end up bearing children that have all kinds of defects because they're exposed to high levels of contamination. And I can't participate in that.
Yeah.
That's such an important reason why we need to buy organic. Now, it's expensive. There are some things you can buy that aren't as expensive. I tend to focus on the best deals that I can. Beans and rice, even organic, are not expensive.
Mm-hmm.
The grains are expensive, and I don't do my nails, and I put that money to my green juices.
Yes, and you know, and that's the point that actually comes down to priorities, and that's something else that you've been touching upon as well earlier by saying, you know, that we can do all these other things, but yet when it comes to food preparation, we seem to always have this, I don't have time. When, again, it really comes down to a matter of priorities with how do you spend your time and how do you spend your money? Because we always have the time and the money pretty much for that what is really, really important to us. And so as we continue to speak, you know, about the environment and the different implications with respect to animal foods versus plant foods, the point is, at the end of the day, as you've already mentioned, is that A, we are going to get something so much healthier, much healthier also for the planet and for the people who work on this planet and live and share this planet with us, but also that is so delicious and joyful.
You can't lose.
No, you cannot. Absolutely not. And so give us a few, perhaps, of your favorite meal ideas that are, you know, just some of those things that sometimes maybe even people don't think about how you can combine foods in such amazing ways.
Okay, well, I just love foods, and there are just so many different ones. It's really hard to think of one in particular. But the first thing that popped into my mind is just because I bought some pears. It's sort of pear season right now. And it's something that I learned when I lived in the south of France. But a poached pear is a dessert. It's like it can be two ingredients. It's the simplest thing, and it looks so elegant and phenomenal. I buy organic pears. I don't peel them. I just scoop the core out of the bottom, and I put them in a pan with a little water, and I poach them or steam them until they're soft. And then, if you want, you can flavor the water with anything you want. I usually don't, but you could put a cinnamon stick in there, or you could throw a little wine in there. I just the water plain. And then I take some frozen raspberries, organic, of course, and I cook them in a saucepan, and I make what's called a coulis, a sauce. And you can blend it in a blender or just let it naturally fall apart and become a smooth sauce. And then you pour that over the pear. And it's stunning and elegant, and it's just a lovely way to end a meal. It's fresh and perfect.
And it's two simple ingredients.
Yes.
And so wholesome and delicious and, like you said, beautiful as well.
It is.
And so
you could get decadent if you want. You could add a little scoop of non-dairy ice cream. You could do all kinds of things. But it's just right the way it is. I find when you recalibrate your taste buds and your tongue no longer craves sugar, salt, and fat, all of a sudden you taste the natural lovely flavors in foods. You don't need to have these sweet foods. I just had a soy ice cream the other day, and it was just so sweet. I'm at a point where it's just too sugary for me.
Yeah, that's actually an excellent point as well, in that absolutely as our taste buds detox and change, what we perhaps thought was normal sweet or sometimes even not sweet enough now becomes overly sweet, and we realize what naturally we should be attuned to or calibrated to, but where our taste buds, I always say, are on hyper alert with the high salt, high sugar, and such.
Right. Now, and I'm a big salad eater. I love kale salads. Anybody I turn on to kale salads, they realize how wonderful they are. There's a few tricks to prepare them. It's important, I think, to once you've got the leaves in a bowl, to massage them with your dressing, which means your hands have to get a little gooey. Some people may not like that, but it just helps the texture of the kale and gets everything all blended nicely together. I like to use a little avocado or sesame tahini. Sesame tahini, I'm nuts about. I put it on everything. And adding a little fruit, like a mango or whatever fresh fruit is in season. Blueberries are great. I love kale salad, and it loves me.
I love your excitement about all this. And this is, again, something that I know we both try to inspire in people, that, you know, to reawaken that beautiful relationship with food that is both healing and delicious and so joy-filled as well.
And, you know, we look hot. When we eat well, we look the best that we possibly can. You know, we were talking about my cancer experience before, and I did a combination of alternative and conventional. I did have chemotherapy and surgery, and I lost my hair. And I like to point that out because I think, I don't know how well you can tell, but my hair is fabulous.
Gorgeous.
And it's all because of green juice. I know that because I've talked to many other women who have been through hair loss with chemotherapy, and their hair never came back as good because they need nutrients.
Yes.
They need to cram nutrients, and that's through lots of this.
Fantastic to hear. Now, beyond diet, let's talk about some other responsible living solutions, such as also, what about our daily lifestyle choices beyond our food? Can you touch upon a little bit something like our clothes? You mentioned when you went to the cattle ranch, for example, you had faux leather.
Yeah. Now, I don't recommend that we wear a lot of synthetic clothing, but I'm not that rigid. And I do buy synthetic things and try and use them. I don't think I consume, I'm big into consumption, but I thought it would be effective to show these people that you can be normal. You can look like you like to look, you can have what you want to have, and still be kind to animals and gentle on the environment. Most of the time I like to wear cottons and natural fabrics. Something I like to think about a lot is what I put on my body for skin care and hair and for cleaning. So when I clean my home, I basically just use water with a sponge and some essential oils if I want things to smell nice, like lavender or lemon or peppermint. And for the harder things, like in the bathroom, if I need to scrub something, baking soda is phenomenal. It's inexpensive and it does everything it needs to do. Maybe a little vinegar. That's it. We don't need to have all these crazy toxic chemicals to clean our home. You know, I have a chemical engineering background, and I used to have great passion for chemistry. I still do. And we're made of chemicals. People don't realize that, but water is a chemical. Everything, we're made of chemicals. So chemicals are not good or bad. But there are some harsh, toxic chemicals. And what companies like to do is continually reinvent their products so that they can advertise and market it differently. And I think every time they make something new, it becomes worse and more toxic and harsher. And you just need baking soda and vinegar and water to clean. It's very simple. And then my favorite skin/hair product is coconut oil. You know, if you can eat it, it should be okay to put on your skin and your hair.
Excellent tips. Thank you so much for sharing that. And again, bringing it full circle, because that's really what that responsible aspect is about, is just examining consciously, mindfully, all of our daily choices, from what we put on our skin, what we brush our teeth with, or what we clothes we wear, what food we eat, and what, again, we choose to support with our time and our money. And those are really, really big factors. Now, sometimes, of course, the message of compassion comes through very strongly from certain individuals like yourselves who are working for the planet, for the people, and for the animals. What would you like to share with the audience on a positive note about that beautiful aspect of compassion and how it actually enhances our lives?
Okay, I'm going to try and end this on a beautiful note, but what I first want to say is I'm not the kind of person that likes to promote the dark side of the world. There's a lot of horrible things that are going on with factory farming. I haven't really spoken about animals. I'm not someone who lives with dogs or cats, but I believe that all living species, sentient beings, should be able to live their lives with free choice and be able to be with their friends and family and have freedom. And I feel a lot for the animals, and I don't express this often, but I hear them. Mm-hmm. I hear their cries, and I don't like to talk about it very much. I kind of like keep it down. But that's definitely what drives me and my work. Knowing that there's so much pain and suffering in the world, and whatever I can do to stop that. But the message is that the choice to make this world a better place, however cliche that sounds, to do the best thing for the environment, the best thing for our health, the best thing for our vanity, and the best thing for the animals. It's delicious. It's a lovely life. It's not difficult. And once you start on this path, I think it opens the door to so many other things. All of a sudden, you're not sleepwalking anymore. Every day, I smell the air. And who thinks about smelling the air when we breathe? We take breathing for granted. We can't do anything without breathing. It's more important than food. It's more important than water. We're dead if we don't breathe. And every breath, it's just like, wow. That's delicious. And just being mindful about everything, all of a sudden, the things that seem wrong, let's focus on the things that are so right, because there are so many wonderful things that are right. And just push the other stuff away, because life's short. It's only right now. And this is what we've got. You and me, connection, breathing, it's all good.
Yes, and that beautiful vitality and energy that is just really radiating from you. You know, I always, always love to see that, because it's so obvious in people who really are not just perhaps teaching or preaching the right stuff, but actually living it. And especially when we are invigorated on a physical level through via our food and via our thoughts and the love again that comes out of our hearts, it shows, it really shows. And you're a living, breathing proof of that. And so it's such a pleasure to connect and share more of your work with more people out there. That, like you said, something I wholeheartedly believe as well, is everybody's message is going to resonate differently with people. And you never know when what you're saying and sharing could be that pivotal point, as we were talking about at the start, for someone else to be the catalyst for positive change, and then the other, and then the other. And that's how we create our society, one person at a time. So Caryn, this has been all so absolutely wonderful. I think your work again is just absolutely fantastic and so positive also, as we were sharing at the beginning, that we do have people like yourselves doing this and sharing and having the courage and the commitment, even when it's not easy. Now, for anyone who is interested, when you were talking about the cattle ranchers, you've turned this into a documentary called Preaching to the Fire. It's available for free on Vimeo. Anything else you'd like to share about that experience?
Yeah, well, you can find it at my website, responsibleeatingandliving.com. And it, like you said, it's free. The Lone Vegan, Preaching to the Choir. It was not something we intended to do, but once we came back from speaking to these cattle ranchers, it was a story that I had to share. So fortunately, we had enough footage and pictures and things that we could put a story together, and I'm really happy with what we came up with. And I would love people to watch it and let me know what they think about it. But I also do a weekly radio program, and I hope I can have you on sometime soon. because I'm not done talking with you. and I have hundreds of interviews, audio interviews, on my website, and many of them are transcribed. We have a transcription project to get them all transcribed for those who are hard of hearing or just want to quickly scan through the information. There's just a tremendous amount of information for those who are looking for it. It's there waiting for you.
Absolutely. And those recipes on your site as well, which I encourage people to definitely check out and try some of them at home. And so responsibleeatingandliving.com, that's the main website. And would you like to also mention perhaps your Twitter, Facebook, anything else?
Oh, I guess you can find them all from the website, but we are on Facebook at responsibleeatingandliving. The Twitter account is real worldwide, all one word. And my email address is info@realmeals.org, and I love to hear from people. If you want information about food, or if you're going through a health crisis, especially with cancer, I have a letter and links and information I put together for those that are going through a cancer experience, and I share mine and tell people what I did that may help them.
Wonderful to hear. And I know you mentioned that still your journey and vision with Real is in the works and in the making, but any other upcoming projects or work focus that you would like to share with us?
Well, we're working on a cookbook that I hope comes out later this year, and we're also planning to do our Swing Gourmet performances in New York later this year, and they're going to be a lot of fun. And then we'll see what's next. There's a lot of work to be done.
Sounds good. Yes, so I can so relate. Yeah. There's when there's passion and creativity and that vitality and drive, it's just amazing how much can be done and how much does get created.
Right.
So Caryn, again, thank you so very much for being here, and also for again continuing with your work. Big hugs. Thank you so much for that. And thank you everyone for joining us. And again, just remember to take, of course, what resonates, what you are ready for, what inspired you perhaps to implement in your personal life, and just release for the time being anything that doesn't, that may not feel right for you at this time, but just being open enough that perhaps something new is ready and ready to be incorporated. Thank you everyone for joining us, and until next time.